Alright, good afternoon, good morning, good evening, whenever you are watching this. Today we go on with the mixing part of the EMP2 course. Last week we started. Hopefully you got an arrangement together or a part of a song that you want to mix. And we're going to take it really slow, this mixing. So next week is the final part, and actually that will be the real mixing part, because these first two meetings we are actually preparing or organizing our mix so that we can mix it easily. Yeah. And also I hope by going through your song in this very intensive way, I hope that you really get to know it, and you can also learn from that, and you really listen to your sounds and you can learn from that what you want to do different maybe the next time, and you get more insight in your arrangement, how it works if you go through all these tracks one by one to organize your mix. Yeah, so it's a slow session, but in the end I hope it will sound really good. So we go on with the song. It's one of my favorite, well, not favorite, but maybe one of the best songs from the album. It's funny because personally I like some other ones better, and I even think they might be better, but yeah, sometimes you hear that when you make the music and people who listen to it, they have different opinions. And when I was playing this song to a few people, or my songs to a few people, this one always stands out. Also mainly because of the vocals that are pretty special, but unfortunately, as I said last week, I cannot play you the vocals because I want to release this song with the record label, and then it doesn't feel quite right, and I think it's not right to have it already out there. But we can work on the music. So I will mute the vocals. The vocals are muted. As you can see, by the name, I already did some iterations. So I always start with just the name, and then I'm working on it, and I might give it the number 1 or the letter A. And then when I go on with that, it will be B, and maybe it will be B2. So it's a variation of B. And in that way I go through a few iterations, and always when I do some things that are really changing the mix, I save it under a different name. Because I had it yesterday, I went to version 3, and then what I sometimes do is I just put both the versions in Ableton in an empty set, and I just A/B them. And then I'm like, wow, actually what I did, because I cleaned up some low end and it took a little bit out of the soul. Sometimes it's technically better, but it takes away from the soul of the song, and then I just go back. Yeah? That's my tea. All right. Yeah, maybe one more thing, because in this phase, which is before the mixing but it's already really far, of course, because you already finished your arrangement, I also sometimes already experiment a little bit with reverb. So you know that you have different reverbs, of course. Where are they? You know, do you want to put your song in a hall or some sounds, or do you want to put some sounds in a room, you know? Or is there a special reverb that you find appropriate for this song? What I do is I put it on the master, which is totally not the way you normally use it. But then sometimes when I'm working on it, I just switch it on, and it's just about the vibe. And you do it a couple of times, and then you're like, oh, it works nicely on the snare, for example, or on the on other sounds. And then when we're going to mix it, I already know that. And this is a big atmosphere changer, so I'm in doubt if I use it. I kind of like it, but it makes the vibe of the song a little bit different. I can play you a little part with and without, so it's now on the whole mix, so it's very exaggerated. OK. Okay, let's play this. This is the second part of the verse. It goes into this full part of the verse. So we're, yeah, this is really the second part of the song. And here's the outro, that's the third part. So you have vocals on top of this normally. Reverb. Yeah, so then I'm listening to it, you know. Do I like it? Do I like the flavor? What does it do with the song? I think I really like it. But the whole setup of the song was first to put it in an endless space, and this thing literally puts it in a chamber, so that's not an endless space. So that's a bit contrary to the concept of the song. But maybe next week I can mix them, because it's music, so you can put stuff in different spaces. So maybe some drum sounds go into this chamber and other ones go into a very big endless reverb. It's also funny how it works on the outro. Let's listen to that. So this is the break without. How it works on the snare. I love it because it's this 808 snare, and then it's this room on it, which is a bit of a contradiction because it's not so electronic, but without and with. And of course it's too much on the hi-hats now. Okay, so that's another thing that you can do. You can already check out some spaces on your music. And then, if you know that, next week you might put it on the bus, and then we talk about it. Yeah, some other stuff that I was also playing with, when I'm here, maybe it's nice to talk about it already. I put in some reference tracks. I put them on the same volume of my tracks, of all my instrument tracks. So if I play this one, it's on the same volume as my song. And then, what I'm sometimes doing is I check the, for example, this song has a lot of low end, so it's mixed a bit fat with a lot of low end. This song has not a lot of low end. I know that. So, you know, if you then put on your master, you put a low pass filter. You don't hear the songs now. So let's just listen. So here, it's just my song. So put a low pass on it. It's a sound that you have outside of a club, right? And then you can compare it to this one. Now I solo this song. Yeah. And now I solo my song. So it's just to compare it, and you can also do it the other way around if you put a high pass filter. So on the master, so let's first listen to my song. Just to also listen what is there, you know, is there some ugly stuff going on there? Sometimes you don't know, but the snare is really giving some ugly mess here. Maybe it's not a nice sample. And now you can just listen. Yeah, and let's listen to the reference. Yeah, the song is a bit softer. Yeah. So they have a double rim. It's also interesting to listen to the stereo image of this. So where is everything in the space? Yeah. So they should be a bit louder. Okay. just to listen to your mix in different ways. Just listen to the low end, play through the whole song. What's going on? Is there stuff that is it clear what's going on or not? Or there are a lot of sounds in your low end, and then you compare it to a professional mix and you're like, oh, there, you don't hear all this stuff, so I need to take it out. And then you go to your tracks and take it out. So that's some of the things that you can do. So when I first listened to this and I compared it, then I found out that I had a little bit loud high end. So the stuff here in my mix was a bit much. So what I then did to compensate for that, I put on my whole mix an EQ, just another one, but to take out some of the high. And that actually made it a lot nicer. Okay. Let's have a look so at the steps. So next week we already started with importing. That should be here first. Importing all your all your instrument tracks as audio. So no MIDI, just audio. Because we're out of the production phase. And that's nice. Now you just have the audio. Then we did the naming on the right, so you give all the names that are clear for yourself. Then deleting the inactive parts. Kijken here. So you know, for every part it's playing sometimes and sometimes it's not playing, and then I just take it out. So in this way you get an overview of when everything is playing in your song. Yeah, so it's clear. So these synths are always playing. This is just only one time. There it goes on. This is more in the end. So it gives you already an overview of your song. So you're not mixing all the time. A lot of tracks. Sometimes you're only mixing 4 or 5 tracks, depending on the part. Yeah. So it gives you a visual. So do that and be a bit precise, more precise than this. So it's really clear. Otherwise you have to think like, oh, if you want to work on it, does it start here or here? Now you just know. All right. Also, the endings, when you end something, just have a listen. If you're not chopping something off, you know, if you would delete this from here, maybe you can see it, you're chopping off a part of the tail. So always check where the sound is ending, and then from there you can delete it. So make it smaller again. So here you can change the size. Okay. What more can I say about that one? No, that's pretty simple. The next one is the coloring. So what I like to do, but of course everybody has its own system or taste, like the tracks here, I give them one color. For all the drums, they're all white. So this is all drums. And then in the drums, they might have different colors. So the kick, these are the kicks. The clap is always white with me. The snare, this is red because I marked it for myself. I still have to do something to it because I imported the mono version, and I think I need the stereo version. Right, so that's how you can work with colors. So maybe for a group, drums, synthesizers, vocals, acoustic instruments, you can give them one color. And then maybe on the right, you can be a bit more specific and give a little bit more colors. But it's all to help you to navigate. Yeah? That's it. Colors, edits, mistakes, stills. This is a lot of work. So a lot of the work that I did, and I didn't do it during the course because then, yeah, I think I might have worked for 5 hours on it or something, or maybe more even. You see, it's a lot of work. If there are mistakes, I can show you. This is one I just found before I started the session. This was on, and then listen, it's this sounds. And this one was a bit weird in arrangement. This one is okay. It's pocha, pocha, that's what it's doing now. And the pocha, cha, the cha is this thing, it's too late. I can play it to you. Where are we? See, you're here? Pookie, pookie. And it's just, it's not working in arrangement. So, in the end, first I moved it and then I was like, okay, just take it out. So it's more tight. What's going on here? Ah, you see, it's also here in time. That's interesting, the clap. Let's see, what is the timing, you see? It's out of timing, this one. So it's flanging almost, so this one should go. So basically this is a lot of work, but it pays off. All these small things, one small thing once only you won't hear. But if you do it for everything, then your mix starts to sound much better. Let's listen. No, I think it feels a bit early. Second one is good. So maybe give it some space. Switch it off. In the music. I leave it in for now. And difficult. Shit. Yeah, I don't want to work on this for. Basically, you really need to line it up. So I just look at this bump, and then I take the first bump that's there, and I try to line them up. And because they're high frequencies, our ears are really sensitive to how do you say, differences in time. Okay, good enough for now. And then let's just listen to the first one. If we replace it by this one. No. Okay, this kind of stuff takes a long time, but it's cleaning up your whole mix. And then slowly your mix starts to feel at peace. That's not the good English translation. Rustig. Easy. Not big and fat and dramatic, but just easy. And that's the first goal of all this cleaning up. Yeah, so I did a lot. You see here, there, different places. Another one that was important was the piano, because it's has a leading role in the outro. And it was just a little bit off sometimes, only a little bit. But and I did it for a lot of them separately, because if you do them all in one time, it starts to. I wanted to feel like a real piano is being played. So sometimes you're a bit late. So some of them, like this one, you know, it's too late, but I think it's really nice. It's like, so this one, you know, and I think that's what you get if you play it. So that's why I do it like that. So you can go totally nuts with this if you want. But yeah, I just wanted to give you some examples so that you know what you can think of. So a lot of it is working in time. And sometimes just stuff needs to be like this, right mouse, and then you not activate, but you deactivate, and then it's just not playing because it's blocking the or it's holding back the arrangements. Yeah. Let's see what else was there. Stakes, yeah, the tail, so tighten it up. Yeah, just cleaning it up. Also listen to the end of your tracks, the tails of all the tracks, what's going on. Sometimes you how do you say, per ongeluk. I'm so slow today. Mistakenly or you export your tracks from another Ableton set, and then you of course set your loop where you want to export, you know, and sometimes the reverb is, for example, still playing and then it chops it off, you know, you should have exported it longer, but maybe you don't hear it because all the rest is just okay. So it's always good to listen to the endings of all the tracks and the beginnings, especially when you did recordings, then you might hear something like go, something like that. Stupid joke. Low pass and high pass, yeah, that one really cleans up your mix. I did it on 90% of all the tracks, so they all have a high pass and a low pass on it. Yeah, and I just want to show you a little bit. Oh, this one. How you can listen to it, because maybe you're like, yeah, what should I chop off? Basically, you have to keep the sound the sound. The sound should stay the sound. Yeah. But there might be some frequencies in there that are not necessary for the sound. And if you clean them up for all your sounds, you gain a lot of space for your mix, because you're basically making space, because some of the frequencies are getting available for the other sounds. Yeah. Yeah, I do it with this one. That's a whole different story. But first do it with the Ableton plugins. So you listen to the sounds. So you do a high pass sound. So first do totally open. So now all the sounds get through, and then slowly you go up. And at a certain point you start to eat up the body of the sound. You see, now it's gone. Go back. Now it's back. And a lot of times, to be sure, you take so now it's back, you take even a little bit a safer distance. Yeah. You also do that for the top end. So you take a low pass, and then you go all the way up, and then you go down until you start to eat up the low. And listen carefully. You see now you're eating up a lot of the sound. You see, it becomes dull. That's what you not want. And maybe you notice the difference between 12,000 and 14,000. This is 12,000. And go back to 14. You get a part of the sound. There's still a part of the sound that's there, but it's this ugly high stuff. So maybe you want to take a little bit off, because it's just, there are frequencies and they're part of the sound, but they're a bit ugly. Yeah. So in that way, you clean it up and you take away the ugly high shit. So in this way, you control the top end of your mix, the high frequencies, if you do it for all your sounds. But don't be too strict. Don't eat up too much of your sounds, and that's why this saving can help. If you've done it and then you listen to your older version like, oh shit, I really killed it, then you did too much. So be easy. If you are in doubt, leave it in. Yeah. So you can also use some external plugins in Ableton, and this is a SSL plugin. Basically, I use it now to also, this is the high pass and this is the low pass filter. It's just the same what we just saw with the low pass and high pass for Ableton. But this SSL plugin, it's a famous brand. And these brands, they kind of have a sound. So you have like SSL, you have Neve. So these plugins, they have a specific sound and they can give a flavor to your music. So what I'm doing now is I'm combining two things. I'm cleaning up. So I did a high pass at 3-2-1. I ate something up off the low end because I think in the mix it's nice. It gives this crispy snare or clap. But also because it's going through this plugin, I impose a little bit of this SSL feel on it. And if you do it on one, you might not hear it, but I did it on a lot. There it is. Yeah. So just that you know, if you want to know more about plugins, maybe we can talk a little bit about it next week a little bit, because then we will be mixing. But I'm not like a big plugin fetish person. I think there are a few brands that are really good. This one is really good. This one I really like. This one is really good. You know, there's only three brands. This one is free. It's really nice. This is a standard plugin. You know, so it's not a lot. So you don't, I wouldn't go to buy or a lot of plugins. Just get a few good ones if you want to get out, because in Ableton, of course, you have a lot of plugins. And you can really make beautiful music with this. I'm not bullshitting. Maybe I'm just lazy with these ones. Okay. Now we go to the... So that was about the low pass and the high pass filter. Oh yeah, volumes. That's another one. So the goal of changing volumes here is not mixing. It's just rough strokes. Maybe I should say it differently. I should have started with this. You could say this, what we're doing today, is organizing our mix so that we can mix it easily, is like an assistance perspective. So I mentioned some names of mixers, yes, last week, like Chris Lord Elch and Michael Brower. They're really famous mixers, really good, extremely good. And I think the way they work, because if you ask them to do a mix, you might pay 10,000 euros or something. They have assistants, even when you pay that. And they do what we are doing now. So they make it ready. So someone sends in the song, then it first goes to the assistants. They clean everything up, every millimeter of it. So they're doing everything like this. And maybe a few more things, like tune a vocal or something. And then it's being mixed by the big master. And that's also with this Chris, it's, I think, a little bit of a strong personality. So I think if you're an assistant, you know, you have to deliver. And when he's working on it in the studio, it's like very expensive. So everything needs to be in place. So for today, don't think about the mixing, because that's for the master. That's what we will do next week. But be the assistant. Think about how can I make this, prepare this mix or organize this mix so that it can be mixed easily. You know, so all this stuff is just to do that. Yeah, and this is a real world thing. So these assistants really do this in a really good way, so that after that, it's just more about the creative way and not solving problems like, oh, I hear an extra tambourine that's 15 bars, why is that in? No, you don't want to be in that zone next week. It needs to be clean, in place, but no, don't mix it yet. So the today's perspective is being that assistance for yourself for next week. So it's a different mindset and it might help. I like it, because then you don't need to think like, oh, how am I going to mix this difficult song or whatever. No, just get it in order so it can be mixed. Yeah. So also volume wise, if there is stuff poking out volume wise, I think an example was this one. there's a trombone. And let's see, let's switch this off for now. Let's listen what it's doing. You can already see it. And there. Yeah, and here. Look at the level. Yeah, so softer, bit louder, softer again, and louder. Yeah, so you can approach this stuff in different ways. One of them is to be meticulous about it. So you put in a utility in the beginning, and I put it, this is a reverb, so I don't put it after the reverb. I want to control the volume before it goes into the reverb. I could also put it here, because then I'm still controlling the volume before it goes into the reverb, but not after. Yeah. And then you can say, okay, show automation, and you could draw it. So so select this, for example, where it's loud, and take it, maybe make it bigger. Take it a couple of dBs down. Oh, that's my phone. Whatever. Yeah, so that's one way to do it. Okay, so that's one way. Of course, you also need to do this one, and afterwards you have to look. Like here's still peak, so it's not good to go up there. So it should be even a bit down maybe. And then you could draw it totally. It's a lot of work. And of course, there's something that can help us, and we talked about it in the course already, and that is compression. Because what is compression doing? Compression is reducing the dynamics, and here we see the dynamics from soft to loud. So the difference between the soft and the loud, that's the dynamic of the sound. So the dynamic is the difference between the soft parts of the sound and the loud parts of the sound. So the dynamics of these are very small, because there's not a big difference. But of the whole sound, in the whole track, the dynamics might be 4 or 5 dB. So what do? You set it here. Here it, I switch off this makeup, because then it starts to mess up my volume. Here, it shouldn't do something. It shouldn't do anything. This is the reduction. So this is the compressor's action. So, and then when we are here, I want to slam it. I want to take out 4 dB or something. Yeah. Okay. See, now it's a bit, the dynamics are reduced, so the sound is just stays a little bit as loud. That's how you clean it up. Take it away, because I already did it, and it's because there's also a compressor built into this thingy. So you see the thresholds and the release and the ratio. Okay. You see a lot of compression there. So it's compressing maybe 6 to 8 dB. Okay. So check out your volumes, and you can see them graphically. So that helps. So you have all your tracks now in front of you as audio. So you can just check, like, hey, is there some sound poking out somewhere? This is all equal, so no need to compress or whatever. Yeah. A lot of times it's on acoustic sounds. For example, recording of a trombone or guitar or a vocal. Yes? So that's volume control. That's part one of volume control. The second part of volume control is maybe, and that's quote, to make it sit already a little bit. So you make the sound sit. It's not the final stage of mixing. Give them already a little bit of a place. You know, if something is playing a lead, make it a bit louder. If something should be in the back, already put it a little bit to the back. Yeah? So remember what we did last week? I think here, with this, you know, it was the piano. So we have the piano here. Okay, here it's playing an important part in the sound. But here, in this break, it should be a bit on the back. And then maybe next week we can do some cool stuff with it with reverbs. But I already put a little bit to the back. So, and how did I do it? Just by lowering the volume. This time I did it here. So this is -7 and this is 0. So this is 8 dB softer than the rest. Yeah, it has a different role, and what can help with this is, you know, is looking at the parts of your track, because there's a big chance if you reduce it, you do it for the whole part of a track. So this is the break, and here it's going to the outro, so only that part is softer. It makes sense, you know. This is another part. No piano, boom, boom. And here it's a break, softer, and the other one, the other sound is going to the front, this one, yeah. So I made this one 5 dB louder compared to another part. Yeah, so it's just giving some rough strokes, like, okay, that sound now is in the front. It's like, I think that's how the song ticks a little bit, you know, coming out there, and then this sound is taking over. So this one should go to the back. Let's exaggerate. Let's see how far we can take this. Maybe with this nice reverb. So that's too much. So go back. So in that way you can check it. So it's playing the story. It's telling the story of the song. It could even help. Let's do that. Let's make this a bit stronger. If sounds go to the back, they sometimes become more dull. It's just like in the real world, if people walk away, their voice is not only getting softer, but it's also becoming more dull. So let's do for that part, let's insert an EQ, and then I'm just going to make it dull. You see? Without. So now the two sounds are fighting a little bit. So with. Okay. So I switch this off and I press right mouse and say show automation. Only here I want to hear it. And I think I cannot give this a name. That's unfortunate, because otherwise it could just... I can group it. Apple G. And then say break filter in break. Otherwise you don't know what all these things are doing. All right. Can this be cool? Okay, yeah, so happy. Here to be back, I think. So the music, you know, that's a this is like one melody line. I think here it should be okay again. So let's split it. Split. Where are we? Okay. Edit. Split. And bring this back to zero. Hoppa. And then we have to switch off this thing there, because otherwise it's dull in the front. We don't want that. A bit loud, a bit softer. Should be just as loud as this one. How can we do this? Maybe put that one there. Let's see. Now we can compare how loud they are. Just make this one as loud as that one. Put this one back. I don't know why it's on another track actually. Yeah. Okay, that's good. I'm going to put it on the same track as that one, because it's just the same piano. And then this one can go, I think. This whole track is empty. Take it out. Let's listen. Okay. Save. So in that's another thing. Don't mix it, but throughout the song, you feel, maybe you start to feel, because you've been working on it a lot, so you really start to know the song, you start to feel the flow. And work with that to already change some volumes. Not too much, because then it's a loophole. So don't get into a loophole. Let everything just work the way it is. But if you're thinking like, okay, in this part, this sound really should be softer, then do it. So don't start to think about mixing. Yeah, so leave everything the way it is. If it's too loud, you know, if it's just poking out, then of course you have to correct it with compression or with utility. Because the utility has a volume knob, which you can automate, and you can draw it like this. Whoop, whoop. Yeah, so there. And when you think in a certain part, the sound should be really in the front or the back, then you can already do it. So you're already helping yourself for next week. Okay. There's one part of the song, I think, which is, because it's coming together quite nicely. I can play, you know, a little bit, the current setting, of course. Okay. sometimes a bit, yeah, a lot of sounds going on there. So if you have an idea of a sound that can go, let me know. Break is clear. And now we go to the difficult part of the song. This will be a one big build up, and at a certain point I start to sing, and then in the end it's just vocals. So it's building up to vocals, but in the beginning there are no vocals, so it's just an instrumental build up of like a minute. And I already got some feedback that indeed at the moment it's not fully clear yet. But to be honest, I listened to this song so many times, for me it's so clear because I made it. But I got some feedback of people who are like, yeah, no, it's good enough. And other people are like, it's not very clear how your buildup is working. So I might have to do that with volumes. But at the moment, I don't know. Is it about the anchors? Because as I said last week, there's I can show you the mono lead, this one is the, let's play it with kick. Where's the kick? Just one kick. So there is the second, then it starts again. Here is the end of the round, and the length of that is 9 bars, you see? And if we go to the bass, which is coming mainly from the, or partly from the piano, that starts here. Louder. Let's give it 2 dB. So now suddenly the lead synth starts again in the middle of a track. So the second round is, the first one was 9 bars and the second one is only 6. Okay. Wow, why did I do this? Wow, the piano goes on. And another round. So I might give them some different colors. So maybe that's why it sounds so, they're different, different loops, loop lengths. So that might be confusing, but how I hoped it would work is that you just feel it as one flow with, okay, it's beginning again, and it doesn't matter where the one is, because for this one, the one is here. You know, the second round is there, but for the piano, let's listen when this is set up. That's the one. That's the one again. So this one is, that's the loop length of the piano. Let's see how long that is. 14 bars. So yeah, these things might be confusing, but I kind of want them to stay like this. But I need something maybe to anchor it. in some kind of way, so that you feel that you're not distracted by where is the one. So the question is for the listener, is the one depending on the piano, the bom, or is the listener, is the one depending on the synth, the... Because later I can play it to you. I won't bother you too much with it, but it would be nice to fix it. Where are some vocals? There. This vocal starts to sing with the with the synth. So this is kind of, I'm answering my own question. This is kind of the lead of the song. So it's this synth. This thing is following through the whole outro. And it doesn't have one loop length. And the piano is just shuffling underneath it. I think that's how the outro now ticks. And so the question is how to make this a clear thing, or that you're not distracted by the fact that you don't know where the one is. So if you have some ideas for me, let me know. They will be more than welcome. If I find myself something, of course I will let you know. But yeah, by giving it these colors, I already find out myself that there are some things that are off the grid almost. And they're not off the grid, but not the normal four bars and then go back. And then same in the piano, so that together might be a bit painful. And then in the end, also the sex. All right, difficult. Any feedback is welcome. All right, so. Make it sit, by using your volumes already, and that's maybe what I also am going to do in the outro, to help the listener to distinguish what is the stuff that they need to listen to follow the song. So, what is the stuff that they need to follow the song? And you make this clear by volume, by bigger volume changes. Yep. So, which part of the arrangement? Or which instruments? Okay. This is a difficult one, but don't stress out too much, because don't think that you need to mix it. If you think that you know if something needs to be in the back or in the front, then just do it. Just the first step to make it sit. That's it. Okay. The low end and the high end I showed you. You can check it with a reference, and then with on the master, the low and the high pass filter, and then you can listen what's in the professional reference track, what's going on there, and then you compare it to your own track. But first, make sure that they're playing at exactly the same loudness. So if you solo this one, it comes out of the master just as loud as your whole song. And you can look at this number here. So first you play the song, and then you look here a little bit. What's the number? And then you play your own song, and then you see if it's the same. And if not, then you can change the volume of your reference here. But also do it by your gut feeling. Just listen. If it feels louder, just as loud, then you're there. Okay. Now I'm going to save it under a different name, because we're going to do one more important thing. For if you have done all this, faders, then the final thing that that really helps to mix, to make the mixing more easy, is to reduce the amount of faders. So you know, there are like a lot of tracks now in this song. These are also there, it's the volumes. So it's just too many faders, just too many sounds to be fluent and make it flow while you are mixing. So how can you help yourself? Try to make, this is a group, but I don't want a fader for all my drums. That's too, then the resolution is too not good enough, yeah? But I don't want to push the faders for all the kicks. What I do want to do, so I have three kicks, I might just with shift select them and then group the tracks, group them, and then I say here, kick. And then you see, bam. I think the clap in this song is really important, so it needs its own fader. So this is just to make mixing easy. Yeah, I don't want to have this with other sounds in one track, so this will be its own fader. Then we go to the snare, like this snare. And we have a different one, this one, and this one. So 3, 4, 5. So these 5 snares, for me, I just want them on one fader. So I group them. So that's done. So this is the snare. Hi-hats, 2, and then this tambourine. Yeah, that's fine. They can be in one group. I don't need 3 faders for that. So heads and tambourine. You see, so in this way, and I'm doing this now pretty quickly, but you might need to think a little bit about it, because I already did. That's why it's now so easy for me, because mainly you just want to reduce the amount of faders that you use for your mix, so that you can really be effective, make big gestures. You don't want that you don't have enough faders, and you're like, oh shit, but I now want to change my second snare and I cannot do it anymore because it's one fader. Yeah, so I take you a little bit through it a bit more to hopefully make it clear how you do this. This is an effect, a delay, so I might have a fader with effects if there are more. I leave it alone for now. Maybe already give it effects. So here we have toms and congas, that's percussion, one fader, group, so toms, congas, you know, so then this is just one fader, and how does the fader sound, where are we? Yeah. I hear now that high one is a bit louder than the other one, so I might adjust the faders a little bit more inside this group, but yeah, this is the ID. Let's listen here. Yeah. So this tom fader is a bit soft if I compare it with the rest. practice. Let's see what it does in the mix. Using this next week, I don't need to think about all these internal volumes. They're right, so I just need to dead fader then. If I want more percussion, boom, I just bring it up. Basically, by changing this volume or this volume, you change the color of your percussion because they're aligned. So if you do more of this one, you get more of the high. If you do more of this, you get more of the body. You see? And in the mix, I like it a little bit dull. Feel stable. So throughout, let's check the end. Okay, so this is good. So you have to match these internal faders in a way that you next week only need to use this one. So if you're now listening to this in solo and then you feel that one is poking out, it's best to address it now. So these things need to feel as one element together with volume wise. So nothing poking out. And then this is the fader that we're going to use next week. Yeah. The mono lead is the lead synth of the song. So it gets its own fader. This synth is the most difficult synth to mix. I know it already. This is a headache. Because it's the most beautiful thing, I think, in the song. But it eats up a lot of space and it's very unstable. You see? Suddenly high stuff going on. And here. So here it's very bassy. So yeah, I'm going to think about this week how to address that problem. I might split it up that I can show you how. Because there's a lot, there's bass information in it and there's high information in it, and they have different functions in the mix. So what I might do is this. So that's the synth, and then I just duplicate the whole thing. And then for this one, I just do a low pass. Yeah, let's see, where are we? Okay, and then so where this is, and then I copy, I duplicate this Apple D, I duplicate this whole plugin. So I have two, and I move the other one to the other, you know, to the original. And then I open the plugin and I change the high pass into a low pass, a high cut. So now we have here the high stuff. So I can work with this under another fader. Mm-hmm. and this is the bass. But that's one of the solutions. Yeah, so if you have a sound that is all over the frequencies and that has different functions, you have to work with it. And there are different solutions. One of them is to split it out, but I'm not a very big fan of that. Because I wanted to, the sound should feel as one. So I'm going to undo until I'm back again. To the original one, and now get rid of the track. This will go. Come on. Yeah. All right. Difficult one. Most difficult of the mix, because it's so important. The thing is, in the verses, it supports the vocals very much. It's almost like blurring with the vocals, being one with the vocals. Yeah, also need to compress it, compress gently, just as if it's vocals. I can do that because maybe it's nice to see. So let's take the compressor, same brand. I like that brand, the FabFilter. You can also take the Ableton one. So. I see that this is the loud thing and this is soft. So I'm going to play from here to here to check what the compressor is doing. I'm going to reduce the threshold, do an easy ratio, so something like this, perfect. Maybe a bit much more. And then I'm going to reduce the threshold and it should work on the bump. On this bump it should start to work. Another way that you can do it is that you make the threshold much lower and then it's working on everything. I make the release longer and then I take a lower ratio. And it should feel natural. And the nice thing of this compressor is it has a dry wet, so you can blend in a little bit of the original. So now you only hear the compressor, and now you only hear the this is the loudness of the original. So if this is 0 dB, you hear the original at its normal volume. See how it sits in the mix. No, not like it. I really have to work on this longer. It's a difficult one. Take it off. Because I just wanted to feel alive and acoustic and not like a crushed or whatever. Think about it. Okay, so gets its own fader. The cork is this synth. It is really electro sounds. That one. It needs its own fader. Yep. Okay, and then here we have this synth. I think its own fader. And then this one can share a fader. Synth outro. All right. And then the Fox's Atmos with the effect on it. There's a printed delay. So I also exported the delay when I exported the song. So it was just the delay effect on this track. So it was below here, and I also exported that as one of the scents. And this is the box apples. Okay. Yeah, so how this is how you go through the whole thing. Pianos. And maybe because you heard the song a couple of times, you already find it natural also that which one of them you need as your own fader. Like the saxophone, of course, you need a separate fader. And this is also outro. You also see it. You see they're happening at the same time, in the same time, of, in the same part of the arrangement. So that's a big chance that they might want to be under one fader. A trombone. Mellow. There we go. Guitar with reverb. One fader. All right. And then, okay, this is the vocal of the outro. Vox. That's that one, this one. So it's to do in plaats van tata. Okay, and then you have the lead vocal, another lead vocal, etc., etc. So I will do that later. So in this way, I will save it now. Let's see what how many faders we have. Let's take this away for now. So then here you see that you have the kick, the clap, the snare, and the heads. This is just the drums, only four faders, and the delay. Then one fader for percussion, easy, one for the monolith, difficult synth, cork. So these are like the three important synths. You see, it's getting really... Let's see if I can make this more narrow. The vocals, I still have to do them. So, does this work? So, if you make them all the same size, then it looks much more. And this is all to help yourself to get organized to mix it. So, to get into flow. You don't want to think about difficult stuff. It look, if it looks nice and organized, that helps. Then you're, you know, it gives you a feeling of control. And that's really nice for the mix. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. 16, only 16 instruments and probably 6 or 7 vocals. So it's like 23 or 24 faders. And that's perfect for a mix. It's already a lot, actually. Yeah, so now next week it's just a matter of, you know, okay, let's more kick. Okay, there you go. You know, I want to have the claps louder. Guitar a bit softer. Oh, that's the snare. Sorry, where's the guitar? So guitar. Maybe if, because the volume is changing, but this is really next week, but let's do one. You can now start to compress the guitar, and then you don't need to think about the faders that are under it. You just compress this one fader. If you want to EQ it, you can do it here for the whole thing. You don't need to think about the faders. If you want going to put the reverb on it, you can also do it easily. Okay. That's it. So this is just work. Sorry, this is a heavy session. But I hope next week it will be, well, maybe I think it's a bit spannend, exciting. Because it's also my own music. And this is one of the more difficult mixes of the album. But I hope we get slowly into a zone that we really understand our own songs, you know, and that you get more and more of a feeling of control over it, and that you already get some volumes a little bit in the ballpark. And I think in this way, by going through these steps, like you get to know your song, you clean up the things that don't need to be in there, you already get the volumes a little bit right, and you get really a feeling, I think, of all the details of your song, and also what are the main instruments, the main things that make it flow. That's like a side effect of doing all this. And you clean it up, you know, this one also will improve your mix a lot if you do it well. Yeah, but save it before you do it, because sometimes you do it too much. Okay, that was it for today. So please make sure for next week you have done this and you have everything under your faders like this, and then we're ready to mix. And I'm very curious to hear all your songs after that. Okay, thanks for listening. Bye.